Good morning, students. This is Dr. P. Chandana from CSE department, working as associate professor. So I am here with the subject of computer organization and architecture. We have already seen in the last classes with some of the topics related to computer organization and architecture. So as a part of this, we are studying with the first unit, that is introduction to computer organization. So in the context of this, we have just understood the basic things like what exactly the basic functionality of a computer and how exactly and what is the importance of computer organization, and why it has been so keen to understand these things as a basic concepts. So for this reason, we'll just have the overview of what are the classes we have been, or what are the sessions we have been discussed in the last class. So as a part of this, we have been discussed about the things like a basics of a computer. So it started with the basic definition of a computer, and then we moved on for the next operations, like how the computer just operates with each other, or how, what are the internal functional units that are present in the computer, and how each and every other unit is being composed of together or organized together in such a way that it has been interacting with the end user's requirement. So these are some of the concepts which have been already discussed in the past sessions. So first session we have been started with the introduction, where we have discussed the introduction and basic functional units. And then in the next session, we have been discussed about the basic operational concepts, system organization. So what are the key components that are available in computer system, and how it has been evolved in such a way that it can handle the user's query and present you the results in a proper manner. Next one is CPU organization, which deals with what exactly the key components that are present in the CPU so that it is perfectly working with respect to the end user requirement. And next one is memory organization and interfacing, which explains you that how does the memory, and what do you mean by a memory, how many types of memories are there, and how the memory organization is exactly developed so that it is being intended to handle the storage. And now in this particular session, we are going to discuss about IO organization and interfacing. Before going for that, we have a just glance about the same definitions once again, and we see how the interfacing structures are being operated. So this is an introduction. This is today's session, which you are talking about IO organization and interfacing. So before going directly for IO organization, we just discuss with the basics once again, and then we'll move on for the operations. So as a part of this, we have been started with the basic things like a definition of a computer. Now, what did we see? So computer is nothing but it is a peripheral device which accepts the input, process the task, and presents you the results or presents you the output. So for this, we have to go for input device connected with processor and presents the result into the output device. So input and output are the basic essential components which makes the system or a computer to get activated. For example, I am writing something on the slide. So without this pen, I can simply explain. But if with respect to this pen, I can explain you very clearly. Even I can scroll the slides and I can simply explain you. But the scrolling is also one of the operation which is accepted as an input. Now, what are the things I am writing over here is presented onto the monitor. So this is called as output device. Now inside the processor, we have a basic things. So inside the processor, we have the basic functional units which are intended to operate the computer in a perfect manner. So in order to consider this, we are using the basic functional units inside the computer as first one memory unit, second one control unit, third one is arithmetic logic. Now, these three are connected bidirectionally so that it can interact with each other. And this is an organization of a simple design of a computer. Now we are focusing on the basic things like how does each and every functional unit is been getting operated and what are the key functionalities of each and every unit. So as a part of this, we have been discussed with the first concept, that is IO organization functional units. So what are the key functional units from this definition we can observe? So the functional units which you have here is input device, output device, memory unit, control unit, and arithmetic logic unit. So these are the basic essential components or essential units which we have in the computer. Now, what does these units are performing? Input is to present the data or simply provide the data. Whereas output is to present the data. Memory unit is for holding the storage of data. Control unit is to coordinate or control the other particular units that have been connected. So, control the other units, or simply you can write it as coordinate with other units. Coordinate with other units inside the processor. And arithmetic logic unit, as the name it is suggested, it is used to perform the processing, that is nothing but arithmetic operations or logic operations or shift operations. So these are the three basic things which you are focusing in the arithmetic logic operations, and these are the basic functionalities of each and every unit. So this is about the functional units. Now, we have said that each unit is having a specific operation, so specific task to perform. Now, when it is performing a specific task, how it is exactly interconnected with each other, which makes to activate it to get operated. So, this is also one of the concerns. So, let us see the operational concepts once again. So, let's start with the operational concepts. So, what is the operational concepts? We have focused about the functionality of each and every unit. Now, we need to focus on what exactly the data, how exactly the data is given, how exactly it is getting operated. We said that memory unit, whatever the programs you are writing, it is stored in memory. Or whatever the data you are writing, that is stored in memory. So, what are the programs you are writing and it is stored in memory? Now, control unit will initiate the task to perform its operation. So, you are simply writing a C program, you're saving that file and you're trying to go for a compilation. So, when it is compiling, it need to execute by the control unit and arithmetic logic unit. So, because of this reason, the operational concepts takes care by means of a control unit and arithmetic logic unit as a major concern. So, what are the data is stored in memory? That is fetched through means of two particular registers called as memory address register, memory data register. So, memory address register holds the address of the data, holds address of the instruction, and data register holds the data from that particular instruction or data from corresponding address. Now, these two are the two particular registers used exclusively by the memory to handle the information transfers between control unit, arithmetic logic unit and memory unit. Now, when it comes to instruction execution, each and every line of the program should be executed. When your program is written, it has been controlled and it has been simply compiled. But how this compilation is possible? By tracing out each and every line. So, whichever the line has been called up, that will be loaded in instruction register. So, current instruction that is getting executed. Current instruction will be getting executed by means of an instruction register. So, it cannot wait for the next instruction to be fetched for the long time. So, what it will do when current instruction is getting executed, it traces out the next instruction to be executed. So, for handling this, we'll be going for a program counter. Next instruction to be loaded. Now, what are the programs we have? What are the handling of operations we are performing? These are performed by means of these three operations or these three registers. Memory address register, data register, followed by instruction register and program counter. Now, the next task is how if at all the data is having for the temporary operations. For example, looping structures are there. addition of instructions with respect to loops are there. So in such cases, it is holding the data for temporary location. So if at all I fetch it from again and again from the memory, it will take so much time. So control unit will initiate a special context with respect to this particular temporary operations, and they will be called as general purpose registers. They will be called as general purpose registers. So these are the registers exclusively used to hold for the temporary values. So these are the basic components involved in operational concepts. Now, when it comes to the context of operational concepts, we have been said that these are the involvement or these are the registers that have been getting involved. Now, we have to start with the basic operations, like how exactly the control unit is getting executed, how exactly the memory unit is getting executed, how exactly each and every functional units which have been discussed is getting executed. In order to understand this, we start with the first thing, that is CPU organization. CPU organization. So in the CPU organization, what you're doing? So you are saying that data is being controlled and coordinated by control unit. Arithmetic operations and other performance of operations are performed in ALU. Storage structures have been maintained in memory unit. Now, how the synchronization is possible? We said that these are the bidirectional operations. So bidirectional operations, in order to consider, we need to have a special interface called as system bus. System bus. So how? What do you mean by a system bus? System bus is nothing but the interfacing structure which you are calling up here is nothing but the system bus. So it is a group of lines which is intended to have a communication or act as interfacing between each and every unit that are connected inside the CPU. So in this case, you have to consider three basic components which has to control each and every unit and coordinate with each and every unit. Because of this reason, we are connecting the system bus into three components, or we are discussing the types of system bus into three essential components. The first one is address bus. Second one is data bus. Third one is control bus. So these are the three special buses and used to handle the interactions between each and every units that are connected inside the CPU. Now, in the context of CPU organization, we will be discussing the major interfaces that how exactly getting connected with operations. We said that memory is for holding a data. So we don't bother whether it is storing now or later or day after tomorrow. We are just saying that data is stored. So once the operation is completed, it may store the data, or randomly it can dynamically store the data. So we have said that for handling temporary or dynamic information, we are maintaining the registers. So here we are discussing the CPU organization as a three major components, but we need to add one more component called as registers. So in the CPU organization, we will be discussing the interfacing between control unit, registers and ALU. Control unit, registers and ALU. So what happens here? So registers will be holding temporary information, arithmetic logic unit will perform the operations, and control unit will initiate the signals to handle the operations. So these are the three basic things which you will be learning in CPU organization. So what happened? So CPU organization with a different control unit and memory unit has been discussed. Now, the next one is memory organization. Memory organization. So in the memory organization, what we'll be considering? So we'll be saying that how the data is stored, how does the data will be manipulated, what is the organization of a memory chip. So in this memory organization, we will be discussing that what are the types of memory, followed by we'll be discussing organization or chip organization of a memory, organization in the form of chip. So generally the memory will be represented in the notation of 2 power m into n chip, where m represents address lines and n represents data lines. M represents address lines and n represents data lines. Now these two are the basic, this is a basic organization of a memory chip representation. So whatever the data you are representing, they will be considered as a D0, D1. If you're talking about the more than number of, more than the data with respect to number of information or data in the increasing space or increasing words, then we'll be considering this as D1, D2, so on, DN. If you're considering the address lines, if the data with the increasing space of address is increasing, then we consider with the A0, A1, so on up to AN. So in order to discuss this particular organization, we have seen about 8x2 ROM chip. 8x2 ROM chip. And apart from this, we already discussed that how the data representation in memory is possible. So all these things are the basic concerns in the memory, where you have to learn how the data is being generally stored in the memory and how it is being generally retrieving the data based on the inputs. So in order to consider this 8x2 chip organization, or what are the chip organization you are presenting, we need to have a special interfaces or special combinational circuits called as decoder, buffer, followed by other things which is called as decoder, buffer, and the third one is FEN. So decoder and buffer are the basic two essential components. In order to enable the decoder or to enable the buffer, we need to have an enable logic by means of chip enable and output enable. So these are the two combinational circuits we'll be using, and in order to activate these two, we'll be using the chip enable and output enable means. So the combinational circuit of 8x2 ROM chip will possess all these things. So in this way, we are having the operations of memory. So what are the components we have discussed? We have discussed about CPU, the help of control unit, arithmetic logic unit, and registers. And then memory unit, the help of chip organization. So now what are the things we are left with? So memory unit is completed, control unit is completed, arithmetic logic unit, this is different aspect. We'll be seeing this in the further sessions. Now we are left with two more things, that is output and input. So we are going to discuss with the input output organization. Input output organization. So input output organization. So let us see. Fine. So as the name it is suggested, input is to provide the data, output is to present the data. So what are the input devices we have? Set of input devices. Example, we have mouse, keyboard, digital pen, etc. Or others, we can have some other outputs like joystick and all. Okay, now when it comes to output devices, what are the output devices we have? Monitor, printer, projector, TV, etc. So these are the set of output devices we have. Now, what you're trying to learn in this particular input-output organization? We have seen that from the past cases, we have been seeing that if you're taking one unit, how it is and it exactly working. If you're taking memory unit, how it is exactly working. So with the help of system bus or other bus, we are saying that it has been executing so and so operation. Even chip of a memory is also explained with set of operations. Now, what you're learning in this output organization? So in this context, we'll be explaining the input-output organization by means of two special considerations. One is input operation is performing a basic task of read. Output operation is performing the basic task of write. Now, how this read is initiated, how this write is initiated. In order to explain that, we'll go with the devices and we'll see what are the devices doing with respect to input and output. So with respect to input, we'll be seeing with the device of keyboard. And with respect to output, we'll be seeing this with the device of monitor. Now there are some cases where both input and output has to activate. So I'm not talking about only input and only output. There are some cases where input and output are also possible. So for this, we'll consider the example of a hard disk which performs both read and write operations. So both read and write operations. So in this case, what happens? We will be giving the input as well as we'll be displaying and seeing the output. So this kind of operations are also performed. So we'll discuss the IO organization in these three aspects. So let us start with the case. So let us start with the first session. So we'll start with input. Input with respect to keyboard. Input with respect to keyboard. Now, what is the context of keyboard? For example, if I type a text like hello, this hello is on the keyboard where it is not placed in a sequential order. The character H will be at some place, E will be at other place, L will be at other place, O will be at other place. So what you are doing, you are just capturing all the input parameters and you are giving that to the corresponding inputs. So corresponding operations. For example, I am typing something. So whatever I am typing, it will take some time to get displayed. So this case of what is the difference of synchronization of this is being coordinated by means of input output organization. So let us see how it is possible. So this is a characters which I am displaying, or this is a characters which I am writing. H will take some time, E will take some time to get into the input device, L will take some time, again L will take some time, and O will take some time. So generally there will be a context called as speed synchronization. Generally computers will be running in nanoseconds. So computer speed will be in a nanoseconds. And now when you type the input like this, it will take so much of time, and this will be in milliseconds. The synchronization between these two timing pulses is not at all possible. So what you have to do is, what are the characters you have been connecting, or what are the characters you have been presenting? They will be maintained at some place, and once it is received completely, then it will be moved to the corresponding output interface. Corresponding output interface. So they will be maintained at some place. It can be registered, it can be any other. It will be maintained up at some place. Once the complete entry of input has been completed, then it will enable to the output interface. Or what are the things you want to perform that has been activated. So this is the way how the input operation is performed. Similarly, output also. So once the output has been generated, it has to stream out to the corresponding output devices. Corresponding output devices. So once the streaming of data has been possible, so here we call it as a stream, streaming of data. Once the data is completed and the task has to project it, it will take some time to stream out, because it has to grab all the data that has to be displayed, and it has to stream out, and to the output interface it will be connected, and from that it will be streamed out to the output devices. And here input device is presenting the data. It is maintained at some place, grabbed onto the output interface so that it is displayed on the output devices. Second thing is, data is once collected, maintained in the interface, and it will be streamed out to the output devices. This is a way how the input and output is performed. So this is input, this is output. Okay. So for handling these operations, we need to have this maintenance which you are making over here. We need to have a special interface called as buffer. And in order to perform the output interface to activate with the output device, we need to have a special interface called as registers. We need to have a interface called as register, or combination circuit called as register. So let us see how this is exactly working. So we'll start with the context. So in this case, you just discard these two, you just display this as two particular diagrams where you're connecting the input device. The data is to be inserted. So when the data has to be inserted, it will be moved on to the internal operations. And here, as I said earlier, for maintaining the stream of data, or for maintaining all the input signals, it is maintained in some place. That place is called as buffer. So we are maintaining that data into buffer, and it is placed onto the data bus. Now, if buffer is not available with any data, it has to leave as it is. If it is triggered with any data, then it has to move on to the data bus. In order to enable the tri-state buffer, we need to use a enable logic. As we said in the previous sessions, every device needs to have a special interface called as address bus, control bus, and data bus. So we have address bus, data control bus, and data bus. Okay. one to display the data or to present the data, one to initiate the address, and one to initiate the signal. So what happening here? What are the stream data which I am performing? Is something like hello I have written. This hello has been first streamed out to the buffer, and buffer is processing the data. If it is filled with that data, then only it has to stream out to the database, because for every character it may not get activated, and for if at all it get activated for every character, it will take so much time to execute the complete input operations. In order to synchronize the speed, it is first maintained in the buffer. Then this buffer is getting activated once the data is full in the buffer. If it is full, this will be enabled by means of enable logic, and data will be triggered to the data bus. So this is 1, this is 2, this is 3. Okay. So data will be first inputted to tri-state buffers. Once it is full, it will get activated by means of enable logic, and the data has been pushed onto the data bus. This is the first operation, and this is a read operation. Now, in order to consider the buffering enabling, we need to have enable logic. This enable logic is explained over here. So, as I am saying that it is an input access, so we are calling it as a read operations. This can be getting the data either from the input devices or from the memory. Because of this reason, we are saying this as I by O, my memory. Now, the buffer logic is enabled by means of a AND gate. These are the two basic control signals which you are initiating. And this has been activated by means of a data pins, that is 7 data pins, or 0 to 7 data pins. So these have been enabled by means of one AND logic and one NOR logic. So these are the data pins that have been used to enable the corresponding outputs. Why you are calling here 7? Because every character which you are feeding, that will be in an ASCII format. So when it is in ASCII format, it will compose the data in bit or 7 bit representation or 8 bit representation by 0 to 7 combination. So these are the 8 bit representations of data. So buffer enable will be enabled by means of a read or I by O initiation of signals, followed by address lines, or followed by the signals of A0 to A7. So these are the set of operations which you are focusing. So this is about the input operation with respect to keyboard. Now the next one is output device. Similarly here also, we'll be defining into two different aspects. Output device. I am streaming out to output device. That means data is pushed onto the output device. So data will be fetching into, streaming into the maintenance register, that is registers. Now once the register is full, data is streamed out to the output device. In order to enable this, we are going for the enable logic. So here also the same constant. As we have seen in the tri-state buffers, once the buffer is full, data will be fetched onto the corresponding data bus, or data will be pushed onto the corresponding data bus. Now here, once the data bus is full with the data, that will be streamed out to the registers first. So once the registers are full, it will be enabled so that it will be moved onto the output buffers. So what are the data we are writing? Once it is full, it is simply moved out to the data bus. Here also same thing. We need to have address bus, control bus, and data bus. So this will be from inside to outside, whereas the previous one is from outside to inside, from external source to input, input to external source. So this is about the logic. So enable logic will enable by means of a load signal. This will be enabling the register. Register will stream out the data into output device. 1, 2, and 3. Now the enable logic over here is explained using the same concept. So here I need to load the register. So in order to load the register, what is the operation I am performing? I am just writing on the data to the output devices. So here the operation is write data. So here the data is written by means of write pulse or write signal, followed by I by O signal, because it may be data collection from the input output device source, or it can be from the memory. Because of this reason, we are making this as I by O N bar. Now the next one is again the same concept. So we will be using the AND gate, one NOR gate, and the address pins. The data lines of 0 to 7. So as it has to possess each and every character in ASCII formats, we will be getting the data collection in the 7-bit organization or 8-bit organization. So it will be reverted to the register load. Once the register load is enabled, it will transfer the data into the corresponding device. So this is the way how the output device is operating. pattern. So this is about the input and this is about the output device. Now, so this is about the bidirectional IBIO device organization, where you have been seeing that it is divided into two operations. One is input and the other one is output. So in the input operations, what you are doing, you are just feeding the data. And in the output operations, what you're doing, you're streaming out the data. So the input operations always use the special maintenance contrast buffers. And whereas in output organization, we'll be fetching the data by means of a registers. So both the things has to be enabled by the same logic, that is enable logic. So what are the operations you're performing? Read and write. So read and write. So these are the two state buffers which you have already seen. So this is which can be divided into two operations. The first one is redundant with the input, and second one is redundant with the output. So these are the two operations which you are performing. So in order to perform these two, we are enabling with the read operation and enabling with the write operation. So this is the output operation, this is the input operation. So in both the combinations, we have seen the same concept. So read is also performed with the IBIO, write is also performed with the IBIO. So because of this reason, you're just togetherly combining this one more AND gate, and we're assigning that to IBIO M bar. And it has been defined with the two basic operations, which is a similar operation of the previous cases. So what are the operations you're using over here? The same is applicable over here. So we are applying the same logic over here to enable the data pins. So this is ASCII character representation. Because of this reason, we are using 0 to 7 bits. So in this way, the data has been fed into the input and written back from the output. So two directional operations is performed using the corresponding concept, and we are calling this as a hard disk representation. So in the context of hard disk, we can perform both read and write. Because of this reason, we are performing these kind of operations. So in order to consider the read and write operations, we are performing the registers or combinations of registers and buffers, both are used. Now this is about the combination of how the data is fed, how the data is received. Now the thing is, if both the things are performed parallelly, it is considered as bidirectional IBIO organization. Now the thing is, if at all we have an issue, for example, system is hanged on and I have typed some data in the keyboard. So what happens when system is getting hand, we don't know how long it will take to come back to the original state. So we have an issue that how long I have to wait for the handling of my data. Second thing is, if at all data is ready in buffers or registers, who will enable them to get activated? Should I send it to input device, or should I get it from the input device, or should I send it to output device? That initiation who will make, or how it is initiated? So initiation of signal is also a mandatory concept. The third case is, we need to focus on a basic thing, like if at all we want to get data from memory or IBIO devices, IBIO device to memory, what are the interactions you are making from to and fro to memory to IBIO? We need the intervention of CPU in between, because without control unit, you cannot initiate memory to get activated for input operation or input to get activated for memory operation. So can I have a direct transfers from memory to IBIO or IBIO to memory? So for these three questions, we have enhancements, and this particular enhancements have been controlled by means of a IBIO interface. So first thing is ready signal. So what are the data is ready with the buffers, or what are the data is available in registers, that will be initiated by issuing a simple signal called as ready signal. So in this case, what happens, it is reducing the load on control unit to simplify the things such a way that when the ready, what is the task of a control unit? It has to coordinate not only IBIO or not only memory, it has to coordinate all the units inside the memory. So because of this reason, what happens, control unit, once it is initiated with IBIO, it will perform some other job. So when it is diverted to some other job, it cannot make sure that again it has to come back to control unit. So in order to come back to control unit, it has to wait. That means something like a we are just waiting in the waiting stage. So that whatever the input operations is performed, once it is completed, it has to again wait for the control unit to come back and to handle the operation to the memory. So something like transferring data to the memory or memory to IBM. So what happens here? Control unit is already available and it is busy with some other task. IBIO, it is already initiated and performing its job. Once it is completed, control unit has to get initiated. So for issuing such kind of signals, it does not have any operations. In order to issue that, that interruption should be made by the IBIO to control unit. So for understanding this, we'll be going for the ready signal. So once the IBIO is completed with a task, it will initiate the signal to the CPU control unit to state that job to complete to completely transfer this data to memory or memory to IBIO. So it's vice versa. So ready signal will issue the signals in order to issue or in order to interrupt the operations of a control unit to get back to the operation, to get back to the IBIO task. And next one is interrupts. So when you're saying that the previous question, waiting state, how long should I wait? So if at all it has been hanged, who will come to know? How come a control unit can handle this? So for understanding this, we'll be going for next concept called as interrupts. Interrupts are generally classified into two operations, two types of interrupts. One is software interrupt. The second one is hardware interrupt. Software interrupt and the second one is hardware interrupt. So what happens here? Whatever the data it is initiated, if at all the data has been lost or if at all my control has been lost, so I'm just waiting for the task to get completed. I'm just typing the characters, but system got hanged. So it is waiting for the acceptance. And I don't know how long it will take to get back to the original state. So in such cases, I need to go for a case called as interrupt. So what happens here? Once the system got hanged, control unit is get initiated by the interrupt, stating that you need to get back to the process again, or you need to get back to the original state again, so that it can, you can accept the input or you can present the output. So such kind of operations are called as interrupts. Next one is the third question. Can I have a direct transfer between memory and IBIO? If that is the case, I can initiate. Why do we require control? Why do we require direct transfers here? Again, I have said that control unit is a major person who has to interact or who has to provide communication between IBIO and memory. As both the devices are ready with their data, IBIO has been, both the devices are ready with the data or both the units are ready with the data, control unit will initiate the signal to get a transfer. That means control unit is already issued a signal, it is performing their jobs, but now control unit is not waiting for them to get executed. It is just waiting or by holding some other task, or it is just diverted to some other operations. Now what happens? Again, here also same thing. So IBIO and memory both are busy at their task. They are doing their jobs. Once it is ready, it has to initiate again control unit so that it can get back to the work of these two operations and divert the data. So why you are using this kind of operations means in order to reduce the load on control unit and reduce the timing of pulses on the control unit. So this case is called as operations with respect to control unit and IBIO. So in order to consider the in order to reduce the intervention of a control unit or CPU with respect to memory and IBIO operations, we are using a direct operation mechanism, so direct transfer operations. Those are called as direct memory access. So without this also we can perform, but they are called as isolated IBIO and memory mapped IBIO. Isolated IBIO and memory mapped IBIO. Third one is direct memory access, which provides direct communication by means of, without the intervention of control unit, that the operation is performed between input and output. Whereas in isolated IBIO, only IBIO will take task operations and it will perform the job. In memory mapped IBIO, it will wait for the initiation from the memory. In both the operations, control unit is a major concept to handle the operation. So this will initiate the signals, which one to operate and which one to act as an output, or which one has to initiate the transfer and which one has to retrieve the operations. So those things are explained using control unit. So as a part of today's session, what are the things we have discussed? We have discussed about the basics of a computer, followed by functional units importance. Next one is functional units. So we have been discussed about the objectives of a functional unit, and then we have seen how each and every operations in the computers have been generated by using operational concepts. Apart from this, we have seen the functionality of each unit by starting with the computer, central processing unit, with the help of system bus. And next one, memory organization, the help of chip organization operations. And last one, we have been discussed with the IYO organization, the help of input output operations. Now, this is just a basic part of a computer. So, this is just learned about the computer organization is generally divided into two basic approaches. So, it has been divided with the basic functionalities. And design operations or internal operations. So, in the context of basic functionalities, we'll be discussing all these things. When it comes to design of operations or design of the CPU or design of the computer, we have several aspects to learn. So, what are the aspects? Let us see. So, first thing is how it is exactly designed, so that what are the interfaces I'm giving, what are the typing I'm giving, it is getting understood. So, for the help for understanding this, we need to first learn about the programming languages. Second thing is how does it is getting operated, how does it is being internally converted, so that machine can understand what exactly we have typed or what exactly we have presented. For understanding this, we'll be learning about assembly language instructions. The next one is, apart from this, so what you have done as a user, you are just entering something or you are just providing something. So what are the queries you are giving? It is getting understood by the system. So how it is understood? By means of the assembly language. Now, internally, how it has been generally organized so that your data is getting operated perfectly. For example, if you're giving the statement as hi, how this is exactly represented? Or if you're giving the instruction C equals to A plus B, how it is exactly represented? This kind of operations are generally explained in the internal organization. So, as a part of this, you'll be learning about the instruction set architecture. So, in the context of this, we'll be learning about one more thing or two more things, like addressing modes and instruction set. So, we'll be seeing detailed explanation of all these things in the further sessions. And this is related with the design of a computer. So, all these things have been discussed in the next session. So, we'll start with the basic concepts of programming language, so that you're familiar with the previous languages like C and other, we'll be starting with the programming languages, and we internally go with the keen concepts of each and every aspect. So, this is about the context which you'll be learning for the further session. So, that means we are focusing, as of now, we have focused only on the basic functionality of a computer organization. In the further case, we have to discuss about the internal representation of a computer. So, something like how it is exactly designed so that your data has been perfectly understood by the machine and it is giving you the task which is perfectly executed. So, these are the things you'll be learning in the further session. So, for today's session, we have concluded with the input-output organization. In the further session, we'll be discussing about the basic design of a computer in the context of organizational structures, where we'll be starting with all these concepts. Thank you.
Like, share and subscribe. Hit the bell icon for more updates.